Good evening to all of you. Welcome, very welcome. I'm very happy that you all encountered the weather, the winds. I'm very happy that Kobe van der Linne managed to come to Enschede from Leiden.
Wow, the tailwind.
You're the tailwind. Yeah. Okay, that's the right spirit.
Going back home is going to be hard.
Yes, you have to go back.
Not as efficient.
But welcome to you, Kobe. Kobe van der Linde, she holds a chair at the University of Groningen. Please come in. There's still some seats left. In the field of geopolitics and energy. Furthermore, she's also director of the International Energy Program at the Hague Klingendaal.
The institute is a different organization.
Aha. Okay. No, that's a very important correction. Thank you very much. Kobe is very knowledgeable in the fields of energy and geopolitics. She travels around the world to give lectures. I'm very happy that she could make time in her busy schedule to come to Enschede this evening. I ask Kobe van der Linde to reflect on energy and geopolitics, especially against the background of climate change. Things are changing, of course. The renewable energy sources shift things. What about power relations? What happens with gas, oil? Kobe, the floor is yours. You will speak for about 1 hour, and then we have half an hour for discussions.
I'll try to keep it a little bit shorter because most of the time, actually, the questions are the fun part.
Okay.
And then you don't have to stick to the topics I chose, but then you can just come. And if I don't know, I will tell you honestly.
A warm welcome for Kobe van der Linde.
Thank you very much. When I got the invitation, this period of time is my teaching time, and then I drive all around the country, so I was a little bit hesitant to. So I think it's really important that we keep communicating with our universities, because energy is, we're going to do geopolitics of energy and climate, but the energy discussion is also very much politicized, which means that we're exchanging opinions and facts don't really matter that much anymore, which I think is a shame, because if we ever are going to figure out what to do, not just as a community here in the Netherlands, but also in Europe and maybe the rest of the world, then it might be helpful if we could at least talk at least somewhat based on facts rather than on just opinions and political positions. And there's also quite a lot of myths, yeah? So solar will solve all our problems. I'm not sure, that depends. I mean, a lot of the facts or the things that is being exchanged, you can see that some of you might have followed, we had this circus of climate tables for 2 years here in the Netherlands. And then, of course, and I was part on one of these the side tables. And of course, what you do there is exchange a lot of technical views on what is technically possible. But that doesn't mean anything if you don't do the economics. Yeah? If you are not interested in the sociology of it, yeah? Is it going to increase or decrease energy poverty? Is it available for everyone? Discussion on biomass, for instance, can be very political because. Is it a solution for the entire world? Do we have enough good biomass to solve everyone's problems? So a lot of these technical discussions are actually not very helpful once you get into more geopolitical and geoeconomic frames of mind. So I always enjoy exchanging these views, and I hope that we can. I take my facts from all sorts of institutions. You will see in my slides from the IEA, from oil companies, from other organizations, IRENA, just to show that everyone is doing their best to present a certain picture. But it's they cannot control the way we read these pictures. So that's where we have to keep communicating, and we can only do that by exchanging views. So if we go to the, just kind of get a historical perspective on energy, and we look at how things developed, I'm just going to flip you through fairly quickly, but you already see a lot of biomass and coal in just after the First World War. And then oil is kicking in. in the 1950s. We can have an entire really nice evening to discuss how oil conquered Europe and what the mechanisms were, but we're not going to. And then oil becomes a little bit more relevant, which is around the first oil crisis. And then, of course, everyone got cold feet, and then oil's share is declining a little bit. But all the time that I flip a bar, more countries are actually part of this consumption of modern energy. Yeah, these are shares and percentages. So, and then we see natural gas come up too. Natural gas is a fuel that initially, when you find oil and you produce it, very often you also produce associated gas. Which, if you flare it, you flare methane. That's not very good for the environment. So very often, the industry already figured that one out, and so they burn it. But of course, when you burn it, you emit quite a lot of CO2. And so what they did, and it's also commercially not very practical, because it's also a very good product to use for power, for heat. In this country, we know all about gas. And if we look ahead, then what we've seen is that even though the shares, and we saw at the end, you see some renewables come in, but if you then look at the total volumes, then you see that the demand in the world is still increasing. I'm going to give the slides to the organization so you can ask it. Otherwise, your neck is going to be like, then you need a brace too, and we don't want that, because necks are even harder than knees, I can tell you. So the world is looking at more demand, and so the only thing we can say is that at least efficiency has increased quite a lot. I will show you in a second. But also that even though we have technological breakthroughs when it comes to new nuclear was in the 1960s and 70s a real breakthrough, and then basically stopped at around 8% of world demand, and we thought that coal would have disappeared already by now because there's a lot more efficient and cleaner alternatives, but it didn't. Yeah, actually coal grew in the 2000s, for instance. Yeah, so this whole energy mix of the world is somewhat of a conundrum. So we need to figure out what is happening and why. Yeah? And so going into the future, if you want to, renewables will grow very fast. At some point they will taper off. But it's by far not enough. Yeah? So if we look at the CO2 poor resources that we're looking for under the Paris Agreement to 1.5 degrees, if we can, and at least under 2 degrees we must, then we still have a long way to go, because this is based on policies that are in place today. So policies need to be tightened up in order to achieve the desired results, if that happens, because at some point geopolitics and geoeconomics also begin to play a role. So if you then look at energy mixes, then one of the things that I find incredibly telling is that Asia, which is now, we call them the emerging market economies, Asia's economic growth is based on coal. Yeah? And I think when the world moved from coal to oil to natural gas, you think that the next generation of countries that is going to catch on is actually going to be at least on oil and gas, yeah? But, so why do you think they went for coal? Yeah? The reason is that coal was domestic, for instance, in a country like China, but also in India, yeah? Also in India, we see coal capacities grow, and so these very big countries, if they make that sort of choice, and then you say, okay, why did they do that? I mean, they also signed the Paris Agreement. And then it's very simple. In most countries, for instance, if you look at China, then quite a lot of the coal was produced in very small mines. It created employment. It was in areas where there was not much that much employment. Same in India. It's in a part of the country where it's very hard to create employment. And so governments tend to go for their domestic fuel. Yeah, that's something you have to remember, because it has to do with your balance of payments. If you have to import all your energy, you become very vulnerable to events in the world. But also your employment might play a role. If we then look at, this is a projection of BP outlook, they think that renewables, for instance, grow very fast in China. The investment there is outpacing the European and the American investments. But still, if you look at the share of coal, it will come down only very, very slowly. Yeah? So the it will still be a coal economy like the Netherlands was a coal economy in the 1950s, where more than 75% of the energy used is coal-based. Another side effect of this is that when, in the 1990s, as a result of globalization, production moved from North America, Europe, to what they now say is the factory of the world, we actually changed gas-based industries for coal-based industries. So our imports have become much more CO2 intensive than when we produced them ourselves. That is also something that we need to address. Yeah? And so Europe can say, oh, you know, this morning in the newspapers that for the CO2 emissions in the world stabilized. Yeah, they stabilized and they declined a little bit in the United States because of shale gas. Shale gas is replacing coal in the US and in Europe a little bit, and it's increasing in Asia. And of course, if you then look at our trade relations and what sort of products we consume, then we've actually exported our CO2 footprint. So the world is a little bit more complicated if you want to. Particularly if we start political scientists look at countries and at power, and then of course if you look at this picture, the rise of China as a CO2 emitter, if you want, then depending a little bit on how you look at it. If you look at it per person, China's CO2 emissions are lower than in North America and Europe. Yeah, so we are still having a bigger CO2 footprint, but as a country, as a policymaker, if you want, China is actually increasing quite a lot, trying to stabilize, but not always doing very well. Yeah. And if you know what the carbon amount or the greenhouse gases, since they do not disappear, it's not a relative problem; it's an absolute problem. Yeah. So even though the footprint of China or India might be smaller per person, yeah. If we want to make the 2050 goals, it's still the countries that have to bring their CO2 emissions down. Yeah. So we're all going to be looking at China, which is a little bit funny, because I'm sure that if you would, before I show this this slide, you probably would have pointed at the United States with Trump as the culprit, as some. The president who does everything wrong when we talk about climate. Yeah? But so far, because of shale, which, you know, in this part of the world we also are not particularly keen about, but shale is actually keeping the US on track for maybe another 4 or 5 years, and only then, you know, they would need some additional policies to actually keep declining. But so far, gas, because gas is pushing out coal, yeah? So Trump might actually retire after his second period, if he gets it, that he has brought CO2 emissions down on a Paris trajectory. Yeah, I mean, none of us is like saying that out loud, right? That's not part of the frame we have. And when Trump made the announcement, the Europeans just switched and they looked at China and they said, oh, yeah, President Xi, he's the climate leader in the world. And I thought, you know, I was sitting behind my computer, I thought, they must be kidding. They must have not seen some of the graphs that are coming out, because as long as he keeps adding coal capacity to his fleet, we're nowhere near. You know how long a coal plant works? When you build one and you take it into production tomorrow? 40 to 60 years. That's way beyond 2050. Do we think that the Chinese people can afford to early retire all that invested capital? Because that's what we're talking about, right? Is that fair? Yeah? So these are some of the issues that are out there. Yeah. And this week we saw something come around that Japan is, they had in 2011, they had a huge issue with their nuclear. They had a tsunami, and the wall they had built to keep the sea out was a little bit low. And so the nuclear facility got wet feet and began to sizzle a bit. And so the Japanese people do not really trust their nuclear anymore. Yeah. Japan today was announced as one of the countries where CO2 emissions declined. Why? Because they were phasing out the gas again and they had turned on some of their nuclear plants. But the support among the Japanese population for nuclear is really very low. So how is Japan going to produce power in the future? You would think that if they have to come up with an alternative, they should go to solar and wind. Yeah, but the conditions for solar and wind in Japan are not that brilliant. You know what? They're going to build 22 coal plants. Yeah? That's not helping. So if we look at how CO2 emissions have developed, then yes, we can see that North America, Europe, we were there early on. We had our share. It is declining somewhat. But the globalization of the world economy and the fact that so many countries are now middle-income countries with industrial capacities, industrial demand for energy is has changed the discussion dramatically since the beginning of the climate change discussions in the late 80s. Because then China didn't really appear on our graphs, in part because we had no clue what was going on there. Yeah? So this is just another one. I really like this one because it must have been done by an artist, yeah, that you can show how everyone moves through the ranks. And to replace the United States, China is big in everything, and not only in CO2 emissions, but also is now the biggest oil producer. Will soon be one of the biggest natural gas consumers or importers, and the same goes for coal. Yeah. So the reason why I'm focusing so much on China is because if you look at energy in the past 15 years, then the rise of China as a world economy has really determined everything we show in terms of energy. Yeah, so it's whether it's oil or gas prices or flows of oil and gas and coal. More than 50% of every change we saw was determined by China. So therefore, it's quite interesting to have a look what they're doing. One of the things that is really good is that China, after being not very energy efficient, has improved its energy efficiency. So they produce a lot more with using a lot less energy. So that is really the good news. Yeah. And very soon they will be merging with the rest of us. If you look at demand again, and I can't turn around. Like I said, I'm falling apart. So I think on the left, I'm going to cheat here. These are the three scenarios of the IEA. And on the left, you see the policies that are in place, which are the ones that handed in for Paris. Yeah? And on the immediate, on the other end, is what they're doing now. So some of the policies still have to be put in place. And in the middle, we see what they need to do to get well below 2 degrees. Well, I mean, there's a big difference between what needs to be done, right? So, what is clear from the middle picture is that the coal capacity has to decline, but so does oil and natural gas. And it needs to be replaced with something, yeah? If there is nuclear growth, then it's in Asia, not in Northwest, not in North America, not in Europe so much. Belgium, Switzerland, Germany are going to retire their nuclear fleet. Of course, what happens when you do that, then you have to replace a relatively low CO2 source with something else. So if you Germany will retire its nuclear in 3 years, I think, from now, 2023, the last one is closed. And the capacity that they will close matches all their solar and wind capacity they've built. So CO2-wise, they've done nothing. Yeah? And if you look at the pocket of the German consumer, they've really paid quite a lot of money to create that solar and wind revolution, because that's what they did. And we should be grateful to Germany because they made solar and wind so much cheaper for all of us. Yeah? But the German consumers are paying a very high price for that same solar and wind until 2030 in their bills. Yeah? And when you look at the climate change efforts, then they haven't really done that much, right? So that's the difficulties when governments are steering somewhere that the perverse effects are sometimes not, even though you could predict them to be there, then the political frame won't allow you to discuss that, that there is maybe drawbacks to the policy. I don't know, I'm sure there's some Dutch people, but when you look at the news, I mean, for how long have we been told that we are totally stupid as the Netherlands and lagging behind and the bad boy or girl in the class and whatever words they want to call. But if you look in terms of efficiency, what we're going to do, I think the jury's still out, yeah? Because it depends on how, if Germany has spent everything its consumers can take, yeah? Then the next step, which hopefully we get there, is going to be a little bit more revolutionary. Germany might not be able to make on its own. Yeah? Because when you are a front runner, you also carry the front runner's cost. Yeah? And so maybe it forces Germany to collaborate with the Dutch, with the Danes, and you know whoever wants to join up. That would be a very good thing because the Danes and the Dutch are too small as an economy to be a front runner. Yeah? So for us, we would basically kill ourselves, yeah, if we would do that, despite what the government claims that we want to be, after being lagging behind for all this, now all of a sudden, the coming 10 years, we're going to be leading. Yeah? So, in thought, I always say. Yeah? But if you look at the world, which climate change is a global problem, because basically the share of Europe in terms of its footprint is declining every year. Not because we're doing great things, but because others are growing much faster in terms of emissions. Yeah? But also the relevance of Europe declines. Yeah? In terms of political clout. Yeah? If we sit at the table, I mean, if Trump comes there with his big emissions, everyone has an interest that they will do something, yeah? But if Europe is declining its relative share, then if we, the way we started a couple of years ago, that we demanded, in the Copenhagen conference, that we demanded everyone to also do X, Y, and Z, and then we would add 10% more to our target, well, no one's going to be impressed, because Europe cannot solve the problem. It's going to be the US and India and China together that will determine our fate, yeah? Whether we will make that, and it's nice if we pedal a little bit too, so that they don't get too tired, but we're not going to make that much of a difference. And that's really hard to take for Europe, who always thinks, yeah, the Eurocentrism in a lot of these discussion is sometimes breathtaking, yeah? So what we see here is that the share of renewables, yes, it has grown quite a lot, but still quite a lot is hydro, and solar and wind, despite the fact that they grow with the double digits, is still on the larger things way too small. Yeah? So there's still a lot to do. Okay, so now I'm going to a part why, because it has to be the geopolitics of climate, why energy per carbon matters. I told you in the beginning that a lot of governments, when they have coal resources, they like it because it's a domestic source. So you can't be held hostage by a supplier telling you, well, if you don't do A, B, and C, then otherwise you don't get your oil or your gas or your this or your that. Yeah. So that's why domestic fuel is also liked very much. But for policymakers, if they have to combine a policy target of security of supply, yeah, and climate and affordability, then all of a sudden the scales begin to change a bit. Coal, because we don't have a CO2 price for the world, is very cheap. Yeah? So affordability with coal is actually a good match. It's a very poor match when it comes to climate change. Yeah? And it could be a very good match when it comes to, when you have it domestically, with security of supply, yeah? Because it's in your own country. But but when most consumers, when they purchase energy, they want the energy but not the CO2. Yeah? So if you can provide the same energy with lower CO2 emissions, that should actually be rewarded in the market. Yeah? But it isn't always. That's the big problem we're trying to tackle. Yeah? So Europe has a CO2 price. China is experimenting around Shanghai also with CO2 pricing in order to get that in. And that all has to do with trying to kind of incentivize your energy system to prefer the more energy per carbon emitted. Yeah? Which sounds a bit strange. And then, of course, it's not just the carbon that is in your fossil fuel resource, but it also has to do with the technology that you use, because you have very efficient coal plants and you have really inefficient coal plants. Yeah? So China has been closing quite some coal, but that was really its very old fleet. So it has replaced it with a newer fleet. That's why its energy efficiency has come down so much. And therefore you also emit less CO2 per kilowatt hour, but still the coal itself is problematic. And we actually looked so then we said, you know, okay, well, suppose we could create a world where we would retire first the really inefficient coal in the world, then we stop building new coal. Well, that's already dreaming, because I just announced all the things that were in the paper this week in terms of new coal. And then begin to replace it with natural gas, which is a very, not a very Dutch topic, because here natural gas is almost worse than coal in this country. Yeah, because we got so conflicted and so much political trouble over natural gas that we don't want to hear that word. But in the rest of the world, particularly also in Asia, actually natural gas, they did a survey of who was willing to invest in clean energies, and the outcome was that Asians were much more willing to invest in clean energy. Much more willing than Europeans and North Americans. Yeah? Then, so one of my young colleagues sent it to me, see, you know, what's going on? It's, and I said, did they also give you the definition? Because when I go to conferences in Asia, actually natural gas is their clean energy. It's so much cleaner in terms of air pollution. Yeah? So they do get a lot more energy per carbon emitted. And so for them, investing in clean energy is also investing in their natural gas systems. I said, but if you ask that to a North American or a European, they will say something else, because for them, natural gas. So it all depends on all this pitching of frames, yeah, is like you might draw the wrong conclusion. But Asia is very optimistic about its natural gas systems. Yeah? If I go to a conference and they want me to talk about the European gas sector, I mean, it nearly depresses me no end. Yeah, I need to take some medication with me to get through the presentation. Yeah, I mean, the European Commission has not come out with any projections on the future where gas did not decline. It's just wishful thinking. Yeah. How do you think the Germans are going to retire first nuclear and then coal and not increase their gas demand? Yeah. I don't know. I do know that they were really upset when the Americans were trying to thwart Nord Stream 2, because if Nord Stream 2 is not completed, the coal plants will not close. Yeah? It's just as simple. Yeah? So, but if you try that experiment, how far can natural gas actually get us? Because that is going to be really important, because if Asia is betting so much on natural gas, then it's actually really clever to understand what it could bring us, yeah? Whether it's just a pipe dream or something else. So this, and we just looked at the electricity sector, because that's where most of the coal is burned. So this is the electricity production mix, and that was the old name of the IEA scenario. This year they really very nice, they changed all the names except current policies. And so new policy scenario is the same as stated policy. I don't know who thought of the name stated policies. I mean, my English is not that bad, but you know, I have no clue what it means. Yeah, like we made a statement that we're going to do this, or I don't know. I would say declared. Yeah, we promised. So that's the same. That's so you can compare these two. So if we start doing what I just said, that we retire first very inefficient coal in the world, and then begin to replace it with gas, then this is more or less what you get in terms of. So this is the top is the CO2 emissions if we had not done anything, and then slowly, no new coal plants get you the blue part. Then you switch the existing ones, you close them early and switch to gas, and then you begin to decarbonize up to 20% of your natural gas, yeah? Which is possible with green gas or with hydrogen, yeah? Either through blending or pure hydrogen. And then you do some CCS. Yeah? And that will get you quite a lot of CO2 emission reduction. And if you then look where that gets you, the bottom line is the below 2 degrees scenarios. Yeah, so it actually takes away quite a lot of the CO2 emission reduction things that you have to do in your economy. And if you look at the power sector, that it nearly gets you there. Yeah, this is just switching coal to gas and cleaning up 20% of the natural gas where you insert it with clean gases. If you see this, then you think, you know, why don't we do this immediately? Yeah? Because what it actually tells you is that if you would retire coal without CCS, I mean, I don't care if they keep coal with CCS or some other technology that doesn't emit the CO2, fine too, yeah? But no CO2 emissions. Then we don't have to decarbonize our mobility as deeply as we have to do now. We don't have to decarbonize our industry as deeply as we have to do now, and we don't have to change heating systems as deeply as we have to do now. Yeah? That's the message what it tells us, yeah? So for geopolitical and geoeconomic reasons, coal stays in the mix, and we saw that the IEA thinks that it's going to stay in the mix, and I think that's a fairly realistic assumption. But it has consequences, and this is very much like we can figure out technically how we can get to the 2050 targets, but once we divide it up to countries and what their interests are and how the economies work, how the sociology work, all of a sudden it doesn't add up anymore. Yeah, this was just like an exercise, right? But it shows you a little bit on what to expect. And so coal leaves us with a lot of legacy, and therefore, if there is, you've heard discussions about carbon bubbles, and our national banks are all getting their tail in a twist over stranded assets and trying to force our pension funds and whatever already now not to invest. I always think that's a brilliant plan. It just means that ownership of fossil fuels will be reverting to Asian investors. It doesn't mean that the oil or the gas or the coal will not be produced. It just won't be owned by us. Yeah, it's almost like our trade. Yeah, we ship our CO2 heavy trade to Asia, and then we can point at Asia and say, "You guys are really CO2 footprint heavy." Yeah. And of course, at the moment, we're really worried that our CO2 heavy stuff is not coming to our shops because of the coronavirus. Yeah. Yeah, it's a long drive, I must admit. So I kept hearing that the shops will not make, perhaps, because people cannot come back to work. So again, if coal stays in the mix, then obviously the investment and our interest should be into creating cheaper CCS technologies. Yeah. If we don't know for sure that the coal is going out of the mix, we might as well try to fix the coal itself. Yeah. So, but do we see any movement on that front? Well, again, here in the Netherlands, we also came to a conclusion that in order to make a first step to go towards close to 50% CO2 reduction in 2030. It's no way, because we have a lot of legacy industry, and you can't do everything at on the same day. So you have to take your factories apart in part and replace them with clean stuff. So if you want to make the 50%, you have to do some CCS, at least for a period of time. Yeah, might not be the end solution, but you have to do that. And that's unacceptable. Oh, it's carbon capture and storage. So it's like you take the CO2, you put it in a pipeline and then store it in an old gas field or aquifer. Preferably not onshore. We tried that, didn't work. Yeah. And then the U that you can sometimes find in there is use. So for instance, there is projects here in Groningen, really interesting, where they have optimized algae to eat as much CO2. So they're very fatty algae, and then you can turn the algae into how do you call them? Eiwitten, what is that ook alweer? Protein. So they're protein rich or they're oil rich. So they, you can optimize your algae for certain uses. So they either go to the food industry or they go to the energy industry. I always say the food industry is important for the world, but you make more money in energy. Yeah, so probably the algae will become energy producers. Yeah? It's quite expected. We're going to skip this one. This is for the film. You can cut this one out. Yeah. So let's go to gas, because otherwise we have I'm already way too an hour already. No. Oh, no, I turned it on early, of course. I can't see now. Oh, yeah, yeah. We're going to race through oil and gas. That's we make it into a Formula One fuel. So if we look at natural gas markets, there's one peculiarity with natural gas. It's not so easy to transport. Yeah? So natural gas in the Netherlands, we put in a pipeline and we brought it to nearly every home in the Netherlands and in Belgium and in Germany and in France. And we even, for security of demand, we brought it to Italy. At a loss, but we wanted to have diversity of demand. Yeah, it's something to remember. In the 1970s, when the oil crisis broke out, they had also found gas in Brunei. And it was found, I mean, it's a typical thing. I mean, of the students, if you go work for a big company and you end up going for drilling for oil, because that's a premium product still. And you have to go to your boss and say, I have good news and I have bad news. You found something, but it was natural gas. And that's what happened with Brunei, because it is a stranded asset. Yeah, if you cannot move the resource to the market, yeah, it doesn't have any value. Yeah, so the technology of transportation can become very important. So by cooling the gas, because gas kind of takes a lot of space, and when you put it in a ship, you can put it under a little bit of pressure, but they still, you know, they always teach in the law faculty, they don't have the chemistry, so I'll try to explain. I said they need a lot of space. Yeah? And if you carry coal, they all sit like this. And oil is a little bit relaxed, but still sardines, right? So you have to cool down the gas in order to carry enough energy across the water. And it was actually the Japanese government who was so freaked out by the oil crisis. They should have bought from more suppliers than just one or two, because they were really caught with the second oil crisis. They only purchased oil from Iran, and they went on strike, and then the Islamic Revolution happened, and then they stopped exporting oil, and the Japanese had nothing. Yeah, and so they were very keen on getting natural gas, but then the gas had to be cooled and compressed and then brought to Japan. And Japan was willing to give the company a long-term contract so that the investments in liquefying the gas and carrying it in these new ships to market was made possible. Yeah? So governments can play an incredibly important role in developing a market. And we're at that same crossroad now. Yeah? If we want to have clean gases in our system, for instance, hydrogen, someone will have to commit, yeah, that we are going to create that market. You need a long-term contract in order to take that investment risk. Otherwise, if we're just going to sit as a society and say, well, you know, we think that ExxonMobil, Shell, BP, Total, they have to do that. And we're just going to wait and see what happens. Well, I can tell you what happens. Nothing. Yeah? Because they can't risk their capital that way if there is not... if they are not allowed long-term contracts. But of course, we've liberalized our markets and we believe in spot markets and all this short stuff. You can't invest on this short stuff in these new factories. So we have to figure out whether we can find a way. But in the meantime, what happened is that Asia became depending on this LNG, liquefied natural gas, carrying it by ship, comes in much smaller amounts. And Europe became increasingly dependent on Russian gas, yeah, which is the big arrow that you see there. You could say, you know, what a dumb idea to buy everything from Russia, but it's the cheapest gas we can get. It's simple. And if you believe in liberal markets, then you buy the cheapest gas. As long as you have sufficient alternatives, that if they want to play a political game with you, you can get your gas from somewhere else. So you can do that when there is large enough spot markets in the world, yeah? And when you have enough terminals to receive LNG, yeah? So Europe has a lot of LNG terminals and they run at a 10 to 15, 20% capacity. So that's why the Russians have not abused our markets, the market power, because there is an alternative, yeah? And secondly, we also had a Gazprom clause verdict nearly two years ago now, that if they are found to be abusive, they're going to be paying, just like the Googles and the Microsoft, the 8 or 10% of their world turnover, and that's quite a lot. So Gazprom, I think, is very wary of abusing its market share. But still, if you look at how it is in the world, it's Asia and Europe that are going to be the big net importers. 10 years ago, the North America would be yellow as well as importing. Increasingly, they had increasing gas coming from Canada already, and they were going to increasingly import LNG. I sat in conferences in Washington where we were discussing whether it was going to be 25 terminals or 8 terminals or whatever. Yeah? And a year later, that whole discussion was useless because shale had broken through. Yeah? And the Americans have more gas than they can deal with. Yeah? It's even there's some projects in Texas that ask for an exemption, yeah, not to put the natural gas in the pipeline because they have to pay a fee to go into the pipeline. And it's too expensive. Gas prices are so low, yeah, that it's actually cheaper to burn it just, yeah, and emit the CO2. And then we think like, okay. But it's because their oil is so valuable that they're going for the shale oil because they make a little bit of income on that. And as a byproduct, they have more gas than they can deal with. But of course, it changed the geopolitical balance in the world, because the United States was seen as the big importer from Qatari gas, for instance. The whole Qatar project was built to send at least half of its project to North America. Yeah? And then nothing arrived. So, I mean, in 2008, when the first shale came, for one thing, I mean, the economy was like paralyzed because of the financial crisis, so nothing much happened. But also there was no demand, so in Qatar they delayed bringing the project on online. And I always say, and the same happened, by the way, to Australian projects. They were sold because gas prices were very high until 2014, so low in 2008-09. Then they increased, became really high in 2011 because of Fukushima. All the Qatari gas then went to Japan, so it was lucky that the Americans didn't want it, otherwise the Japanese would have been in trouble. There was this developed gas available. And the Australian projects were invested in based on prices of that time. So China has purchased quite a lot of LNG for $18 per MBTU, which is a unit of sale. And now the price is $5. So when the Australians were done creating their projects, you know, they said, just like they told the Qataris before, the ones who had contracted the gas, why don't you drop a screwdriver somewhere in the project and then send a five-year-old to find it, and hopefully that takes at least 3 years. Yeah. Because otherwise, the minute you start producing, the banks, you know, you need to start paying the banks. So it's better not to operationalize your project than to do. So that's one of the things that's playing a role. But still, the IEA thinks that quite a lot, most of the gas, the new gas that it will be found in the future, will go to Asia. It's not just China. India is difficult because they have hardly any infrastructure and their pricing system is so complicated that they've tried to explain it to me and I still don't get it. But maybe not India, but other Vietnam, other countries are definitely, Thailand, are interested. And then obviously Europe, I couldn't resist putting Nord Stream 2 in. I mean, just to talk about it is a bit silly because Nord Stream 1 didn't really encounter that much problems. Yes, Poland was not happy and the Baltics were not happy. First, they were offered a fork off the pipeline. So they would could also be supplied through Nord Stream, but Poland and the Baltics didn't want that. Then two LNG terminals were built, one in the Baltics and one in Poland, so they had an alternative to Russian gas. We had a crisis with the Ukraine, and the Ukraine's been supplied through Europe, so we brought the Russian gas to Germany, and then, yeah, you're laughing, but that's what happened, yeah? Yeah, when you have a fight, you know, you get principled and cost is not an issue. So they would purchase the gas on European markets and then it was sent back through the Czech-Slovak pipeline because they are they can go both ways. Now with Nord Stream 2, that encountered a lot more problems. And that has in part to do with the fact that the US has become a substantial exporter itself. But also because they both land in Germany and are then the gas goes further into Europe, in part to Italy, north-south connection, Opal. And actually the Netherlands is also interested because since we decided to close our gas production early, what is it, 2023, we actually need an expansion of the pipeline system through North Germany in order for us to have gas because we're building a nitrogen plant to bring it up to Groningen standard, but if we don't get gas, our heaters don't work on nitrogen. Yeah, so we need gas. We don't want to discuss this. Okay, so one of the reasons is that LNG from the United States is increasingly coming to Europe, and actually in the past year we've seen this. Remember when Juncker went to visit Trump because there was, you know, issues? He offered freedom gas, which I thought was funny. And so Juncker promised that Europeans would buy more American gas. I mean, he's not the boss of gas, right? It's private companies who purchase gas. But what happened is that China and the US were in a trade war. And so China put a 25% trade tariff on LNG, on American LNG, so it could take from Brunei, Qatar, and from Africa and Australia, but not the US. So all of a sudden, this American LNG was, people had invested a lot of money in liquefiers and nowhere to go because all the American LNG previously had been contracted on, not on a long-term contract, but short-term contract was going to Asia because there you could get a premium price for your natural gas, much better than in Europe. But when the Chinese didn't want the gas anymore, it was left over. So they began to push it, into the European market because that's the market of last resort. Yeah? There's a lot of terminal capacity, so you can always get rid of it. And so European gas prices have been very nicely low as a result of that gas coming. It has tapered off already. And I wonder what the Chinese will do now, because their economy is badly hurt by the virus. But anyway, so... And then the Americans, when they use the argument to stop Nord Stream 2, they say, oh, you know, Germany and all these others, they spend all this money and they're financing Putin. And then the way they pronounce the name Putin is always like, you know, need a window wiper. Putin. But if you look at the income from oil and gas, yeah, how much of Europe's imports of energy and how much we spend on Russian oil and gas, then actually it's fairly modest, yeah, if you start digging into the numbers again. So I don't know where this comes from, but it's a frame that was very much alive, that we are financing. And yes, the energy income for Russia is important, but it's asymmetric. Yeah. And that's also something you will never hear. Okay, let's move up a bit. So events. So this is crude oil prices. So we've seen them zigzag quite a lot. And particularly the last bit, we've seen oil prices, where you see it go up and then it goes down. Why did they go up in the red bit, huh? Not the historical bits? What do you think? When?
Oil.
Yeah, this is oil. It's really recent, yeah.
Iran.
No, it's not that recent.
ISIS?
Hmm?
ISIS?
No, that's too long ago.
Yep.
See, the fact is, no one remembered. You know, when we made scenarios, and in any scenario we ever made, and we would lose 5 million barrels from Saudi Arabia, the whole world would be on fire. Yeah? That was the worst scenario ever. And what happens in the fall? Abqaiq gets bombed. That's the biggest oil treatment center in the world. 5 million barrels, chook, off the market. Prices go up a little bit and come down. Why do they come down? The Saudis were very open in their communications. I think we have to be grateful for that, because maybe 10 or 15 years ago, they would have been very mystical about what was hit. Now they immediately showed pictures. And also had a lot of, because the oil market has been in oversupply, they had a lot of storage. Yeah? So they had produced the oil but kept it above the ground and could supply their clients with from their storage. They repaired it very quickly, yeah? So they called in all the troops to repair at least the oil site. What they never told the world is that the Saudi industry works on associated gas. And when you have an oil treatment center, you separate the oil and gas there, and so they didn't have any gas. So that means, in some places, no drinking water, yeah? Because they have desalination plants working on gas. I mean, of course, the only thing we are interested in, can we drive our cars? And, you know, we're not interested in all whether Saudis can drink water or cool their houses or whatever. I mean, that's has never been part of the narrative, right? We don't ask that sort of thing. Okay, and then OPEC got together because prices weakened again, and now we're really low. So why are we down now? It doesn't need anything. They have no one to unload the ships. Their whole logistical system at the moment does not work. So even though they have ordered the goods, you just can't land them. Yeah? So the whole supply to China, which I told you already is so important, is now gone. Yeah? So if you look at the oil price effects of the virus, it's just a couple of weeks. OPEC had just decided to cut production a little bit to support prices to $75. That would have been good for at least for the producing countries, for everyone. And now this crisis is happening and prices are really low. Yeah, $50 in the US and a little bit more for the rest of the world. Okay. And then you're right, we also had a crisis around Soleimani. And you know what also coincided with taking out the 5 million barrels of Saudi Arabia is that the American sanctions were tightened in May of last year. And in September, 3 million Iranian barrels were also taken off the market. So we're talking about 8 million barrels less. No OPEC policy ever took that much barrels off the market, yeah? And prices are hardly moving. So for me, it's time to retire because I don't get it anymore, yeah?
Gobi, could you do 5 more minutes?
Yeah, okay. I'm going to, this is the last bit, and the energy transition bit we can do in the questions. So if you look at oil flows, you saw with natural gas, I could give you a technical reason why the market was not maybe as global as you thought. But this picture that I show you now, if I had shown you the one from 10 years ago, then you would see oil flows go all over the market. Our oil market was much more, in physical terms, much more globalized. Again, the growth in Asia has actually regionalized international oil markets again, because most of the oil in the Middle East is going that way. Yeah. And again, as a result, most of the oil that Russia produces is now coming to Europe. So in this age of globalization, you see some kind of division of labor coming up that even though maybe in price-wise we have global markets, but when you look at the physical flows where you look when you look at risks, whether there's any bottlenecks in your supply lines or all that sort of thing, you have to look at the physical flows. Yeah? And there we see this regionalization taking place, and it doesn't really change that much if we look at refined products, if we add them up. Yeah, so I thought I should share that. Then here we see the rise of shale, and it's already so far that the United States is now the biggest oil producer in the world. Yeah, I mean, they were the biggest importer for nearly 40 years. They have now given the baton to China, who is now importing more than 10 million barrels. But now the US is nearly, is become a net exporter. If you then, I've just got one too far. And here's already, you see how much Asia is depending on the Middle East. So if you think in terms of geopolitics and who was the policeman in the world, yeah, who was fighting all these conflicts and interfering in the Middle East, it was always the US. Yeah. And when the Iraq war in 2003, we said that they moved in because of the oil. Yeah. Actually, after the dust settled, it was only Asian investors and European investors who invested in Iraqi oil, not the American companies. Yeah. So, that's maybe another myth that you can uncover. But now, do they lose their interest in the Middle East? And is the interest of Asian countries now so large that they have to worry about all these conflicts going on in the Middle East? And at the same time, we see Russia much more active than we've seen them in a long time in the Middle East, in Syria, and with Turkey, and with Iran. Why? Because it's frustrated by Europe and North America. I mean, they never really were allowed to become part of the West. Yeah, they're not too keen to become part of the East because they feel strategically threatened with a lot of border and very little people to defend it. And so they're moving south. Yeah. I think we're going to the end now. And then if you look at security of supply, then actually Asia, if you look at all the bottlenecks in supply, the Strait of Hormuz, Strait of Malacca, it's actually Asia that has quite a lot of issues. We tend to show this picture and then it only shows you the oil bottlenecks or the oil things that could go wrong there. But natural gas or LNG is passing through the same bottlenecks. Yeah? So the problem is a little bit more complicated. Yeah? And so if you read about today, the announcement came that the Philippines want the Americans to go and they want to get closer to China. That would be a major breakthrough strategically for China if it could break out of the island ring. Yeah, if it could somehow break out of the island ring, and that's a strategic battle that is going on in terms of energy, because whatever we say, the Americans might have retreated on their own continent. They're still boss of most of the strategic places in the sea, and therefore they monitor these flows. The Europeans have been very happy with the Americans monitoring that because it's not cheap. Yeah? So we've been piggybacking on the US, and when the US complains about the European payments, they have a point. Yeah? You can calculate it, what they did for oil, that's not a small bill. Yeah? But in Asia or in China, they're not so keen on the Americans making sure that the oil reaches markets. Yeah? They might not be strong enough to do it themselves, but they're also not happy with the current policemen. Yeah? So there is a lot of tug of war going on. And of course the result is, when I say that China is investing quite a lot also in solar and wind, they're doing that in part because it helps their CO2 footprint, but it also helps their domestic production. Once you have the solar and wind in your economy, it becomes domestic. And that is also, I think, a driver in Europe, which is much stronger than just the climate change narrative. When you get solar and wind in your economy, it becomes domestic. Yeah?
Kobi, thank you very much.
This was it. Sorry.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for uncovering a lot of energy myth. That was really interesting, and it was nice to see the whole world through your energy perspective and how things are shifting.
It's really warped, right?
Yes, it is.
That's the life I live.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm looking through these tiny goggles.
Yeah, but it was really, really mind-opening, so to say. So thank you very much. I can imagine there are a lot of questions. I have a mic over here. And Kobi, when I read this afternoon, I was preparing myself, I read an article which stated that in 2050, approximately, yeah, when we go on using gas, oil, etc., all supplies will be used. And that's the end of the... Is that true? Or not?
No.
Or is there some gas around the North Pole? Could you just say something about this? Why not? How long can we go on using gas, oil?
Well, you're a physicist, so for you it's an absolute amount.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a stupid political scientist, so I can make up some other truth. I would say that theoretically I could prove that energy is also a social construct.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes resources become a resource and then they unbecome a resource.
Mm-hmm.
I can explain with rare earth. Used to be produced in California mainly, yeah, as a byproduct of mining, and then mm-hmm. they introduced environmental legislation, became too expensive in the US to continue producing the rare earth. And so they then got it in China because there was no environmental legislation, and so it was really cheap there. And now we blame China for being, because they built their industrial policy on the rare earth, that they are monopolizing the markets. And if the price of rare earth will go up enough, then you can produce again in Australia, in California. So
mm-hmm.
I would say reserves are an economic definition. So there's plenty of reserves.
Mm-hmm.
If the price
mm-hmm.
is high enough, we might have scarcity, because the oil prices and gas prices have been very low since 2014. So we've had very little investment except in the US.
Mm-hmm.
But even in the US, the investors are getting really tired of the shale producers not really making much profit. Yeah. So we will see how they can stay in the business.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't think, and if you look at solar and wind, I'm still trying to figure out what would be the economic rent on solar and wind. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I haven't quite cracked that problem, because once you have economic rent,
mm-hmm.
then you know you have nice profits, because it's a payment above your normal productivity.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No, but I don't think that we will stop with coal, because we have so much coal in the world that if we want to burn it all, then we really burn it. then there's nothing left of us. That's a self-defeating oil and gas. Maybe it will be finished like in the Netherlands, where there is plenty of gas left in the Netherlands, but we decided for reasons of safety that we leave the natural gas in the ground, but that doesn't mean that it's not there. And there's a lot of places where we do these things, or we like consuming gas from Russia because we and it's not as if the ecology of Siberia is not very precious. It's just that we find our Vaden Eilanden here up north more precious than Russian ecology, and therefore we get it from Russia. I mean, so I don't know. I mean, I always get a little bit confused when people think that it's going to be finished.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I don't think so.
No. That's a clear clear answer. And to ask another question, and then I give the floor to you. Should we be afraid of Putin closing the gas lines, or is that, you read it sometimes, but I can't imagine it because he invests a lot in the...
There's an asymmetric dependence, so he, although with gas, if we're really honest, he makes more money on sending oil to us than sending gas. You saw that maybe quickly in the picture. So it might be tempting, but for Gazprom, it's really important that they keep sending the gas. There is a big discussion in Russia from other Russian companies to break the monopoly, the export monopoly of gas to Europe, so they can also send gas. So Gazprom has a lot of economic interest to keep to defend its market share here. I don't think it will. But it's just like in 1990 with Saddam Hussein, you also thought he would never be so so stupid to move into Kuwait, and he did. Yeah, I mean, you could rationalize quite a lot of things. So yes, it could happen, but I don't think so. I mean, as long as we have relationships, and that maybe that's the answer. As long as you have some channels of communication and vested interests in each other, then maybe the likelihood is smaller, because you the problem I have with certain geopolitical movements is to, when you isolate a country for Europe, Russia will always be our neighbor. So maybe an isolated Russia is for us is more scary than a Russia that we engage with, even though we don't like some of the developments in their society.
So, okay. No, that's a clear answer. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Who dares? Go ahead.
Yes, please could you tell something about the influence of the Energy Charter Treaty on the energy transition?
The energy.
I don't know, or zero. But that's just guesstimating. I don't know. I don't think that it plays a role at all at the moment, because Russia is not really participating in it anymore. The U.S. never did, and so I have no idea what's. They're still working on investments, but for energy transition. I also know that the EU Russia strategic discussions we also had on energy. Are also not very regular anymore, so I don't know. And we were discussing at the time when they were still before the sanctions, we were discussions with Russia on energy transition, but also the contribution they could make, because they have a lot of biomass, potentially. They have a lot of empty gas fields that we can store CO2 in. They have really nice new pipelines that can take hydrogen. Russia is an, also in the future will be a partner in energy, whether we like it or not. Yeah, but the charter treaty, I don't know. I honestly I stopped reading about it. Maybe that's an answer too.
That's an honest answer. And Kobi, when we look to sustainable technologies, do you think in the future it will be let me rephrase my question. Oil and gas, there was a lot of power politics about it. So it was important to keep the Strait of Hormuz free, for instance, things like that. Will there also be power politics about sustainable technology, like, for instance, solar parks in the Sahara, things like that? Could you comment a bit on those?
Yeah. I think already at the moment, if I read the news on IS expanding in the Sahara, it's already a showstopper for all our dreams on building the whole Sahara full. If you know, it's mm-hmm. it's not ours, so I think it's a little bit presumptuous to say that we can just build all our solar there.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, Morocco is very interested. But Libya and Algeria might not be stable enough. And then we have the issue, and we're looking at that. Mm-hmm. If you bring it to market in electrons, whether we can do that competitively, or whether we actually need to convert it to hydrogen, so that and then you have the same discussion as with natural gas. If you do it in a pipeline, mm-hmm. you have a connection between A and B, and therefore people feel. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you look from a security of supply point of view, then the relationship with the Soviet Union and Europe was very stable because we were stuck with that pipeline. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Now, in the world, it's seen as something that creates instability, because you are both connected and you can't pick up the pipeline and say, well, I don't like you anymore, I'm going somewhere else. Yeah, that's not working. But maybe for new technologies, you actually need that long-term relationship because you still need to expand. You start with a little. You need to and now we say we like to go to any market we want, but really we need a couple of contracts with a starter market to get it going. So I'm not really sure whether it will be pipeline or electrons.
Mm-hmm.
There's still issues. I mean, if I go to Saudi Arabia every once in a while and they have a lot of solar, you would think the country is very well positioned,
mm-hmm.
but they have a lot of dust coming in and mm-hmm. and the labor force that you need to, I mean, it's like a housewife's terror there. I mean, all the time you have to dust these things off. So the efficiency of your panels is not very high.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what I find strange is that we dream about the Sahara and we're not looking at fairly economically needy parts of Europe that also have a lot of sun in southern Spain and Italy. I don't get that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. We've been sending money there to keep these places going forever. And now that we need to invest, we look at the Sahara where, you know, everyone in creation is running around doing something they shouldn't be doing. And we skip southern Spain. Mm-hmm. I don't get that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I would keep it within the EU to see whether the technologies work, mm-hmm. make the distances smaller. We could maybe finally realize some sort of energy connection between Spain and France, mm-hmm. which has mm-hmm. been incredibly difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And if that is really successful, then you can cross the Mediterranean. But, you know, I'm a stupid person with no money, so.
Yeah. Okay.
What do I have to lose?
Yeah. Thank you. I see a couple of questions. Go ahead.
Why hasn't nuclear caught on like oil and gas and coal?
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't catch on?
Yeah.
Yep. Thank you.
For two reasons. Nuclear is a technology that can be used for defense reasons, so there was all sorts of treaties of not spreading that technology, which we weren't very successful at. I mean, I think the Dutch had a small role to play in opening the front door and the back door and
being
as international as we always are and sharing the knowledge. You know, we're very naive people, so...
we heard it last week with the Stuxnet virus and the... But yep.
Yeah, yep. I mean, it's like amazing. And we have this discussion again, and we're still naive, but anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So that walked out of the door and then went to Pakistan and Iran.
Mm.
Libya also had the knowledge. So, I mean, so that was an issue. And it's the nuclear waste that was always an issue. And even though, if you look at the accidents, we have Chernobyl, we had Fukushima, Harrisburg. If you would count the number of victims of coal mines, I think you would you would come up with a number that nuclear is actually a safe technology. It's just that mm-hmm. and that's the danger also for new technologies, the way we talk about them and sometimes communicate about whether it's solar and wind. And okay, now when I came driving to here, you see a lot of farmland. The government want to take the farmers away. Well, they should say less animals, not the farmers. And then the farmer is sitting there at his kitchen table, and then what is he going to do with his land? And then one of these solar cowboys come and said, you know, I can offer you, you can sit at your table, drink your coffee, and you make 75,000 a year, yeah? And he doesn't make that sort of money when he's struggling with his farm, yeah? Fortunately, our electricity net is way too small to take all these plants, yeah? Mm-hmm. I mean, you could say this is really bad, so all this new technology cannot be built, but maybe, because we have bottlenecks, we begin to think a little bit straight, yeah? Where do we want these things to be, yeah? Do we want the entire part, you know, for the people from the Randstad, this is an empty land anyway, so we can just fill it up, yeah? Put a couple of windmills, you know, in front of people's face. I mean, I understand why people get angry. I mean, I grew up at the sea, right? For me, space is a lot of sky. Mm-hmm. And someone who lives in a city shouldn't tell me, yeah, when my sky is being interrupted by a couple of, that something has changed for me in terms of my sensation of space, yeah? Mm-hmm. I'm cool with that because we all have to do something, yeah, in order to make this happen. But you can't tell me that it didn't change, yeah? And we're still in the political part of the discussion where we have good people and bad people and stupid people and clever people, and we should stop that. We should acknowledge that some people have to carry the burden, yeah? We've been so lucky in this country that so far, yeah, first we had Limburg and then we had Groningen and a little bit of Zeeland with a nuclear facility, mm-hmm. yeah? So we had very centralized energy producing parts of our economy, yeah? So the cost and benefits were not distributed evenly, yeah? Mm-hmm. And now we're going to technologies that at least the costs are going to be spread out a lot more. It's going to be in our face, yeah? But we need to do that. But then we also have to acknowledge that, yeah? I mean, I come from Zeeland, yeah? When I was young and still very active, they made an argument that the nuclear facility should be in Zeeland because there was less Zeeuwse people, which is a fact. So if it does boom, yeah, you kill less Zeeuwse people, yeah. Mm-hmm. This people in Zeeland accepted that argument as something logical that you don't put it in a big city, mm-hmm. yeah? And they understood that was the burden they had to carry for the country. Mm-hmm. They do expect the country to show some solidarity when the thing has to be broken down. Yeah? Just like the people from Groningen expect a little bit of solidarity mm-hmm. now that we're at the tail end and at the costly part of our production. Mm-hmm. I went to school because of Groningen. Yeah? I didn't come from a social background which would have put me in university, yeah? And because there was gas money in the Netherlands, we became very prosperous, mm-hmm. and we built this place, yeah? Mm-hmm. Yes. It's gas money. Mm-hmm. We built Maastricht, it's gas money, yeah? As a university. And I could go to school. So, I mean, there's the cost and benefits, and that's the discussion we're not doing very well with the renewables. And that's why we're trying. You see, if you talk about renewables, it's not just power, yeah? Solar and wind is not going to help us. How much do you think electricity is a part of our energy consumption?
5 to 10 or something?
20% on average, yeah? Mm-hmm. So if we double that, that's a massive change, right? So we will drive some electricity, we might heat some houses. Yeah, so that and some industry might actually have an electric furnace rather than a gas burner. Yeah, that still leaves 60% where we need to do something. So we need a molecule to fix that, because the electricity transportation is much more expensive. strengthening the electricity net is very expensive. So if we want to keep it affordable, we need to be clever. So we need a backbone, just like we had oil and gas. Mm-hmm. We're going to need electricity with a molecule. And so now we're trying to figure out what molecule is going to be. Is that going to be hydrogen or methanol or ammonia, whatever. And it looks like hydrogen can be carried in our gas grid, which is legacy. Yeah? But if we can reuse legacy, we can lower the cost for the population. And maybe we cannot use all of it, but we can use, against some investment cost, a good chunk of it. And that is the sort of solution we need to find, so that we can't change everything, that only electricity is the answer, because we can't absorb all the electrons on a day that is really windy and sunny at some point. And that point will come already by mid this decade, that the grid will just not be big enough. So we need to organize sponges, and the sponges are conversion into something we can store, something we can burn, something we can use. Yeah? And so our industry might be a really interesting place to become our new sponges. So rather than look at the industry in the Netherlands and say, oh, you know, you guys are really dirty and bad. No, we need to look, because they have the knowledge and the capital to turn themselves into our sponges. And we need that. Otherwise, all this intermittent stuff is not going to help us. Yeah. And at the same time, we have to bring our population along, that we're going to make these steps. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah? That's a really nice answer to your nuclear question.
That's what I learned. Well, you can't, nuclear, no one wants to invest in it here anyway.
Yeah. Okay, I go to the next question. Go ahead.
Thanks for making me quite pessimistic tonight. So where is the hope?
Kobe, where's the hope?
The hope was in what I was just saying, that we're trying to figure out, and that's also what I showed, that if we would convert to cleaner gases and get the coal out, then technically it's possible, and I think we're getting pretty close to getting it economically done. Politically, the world is more divided than ever, and that's where I also get pessimistic. Yeah. Because it stimulates the wrong things in us, yeah? Because the world would be better off if we actually exchange the technologies, and not close each other out. But we're not living in that world at the moment. I mean, I don't know, when you look around you, the question is, should we stop doing what we need to do here? No, because I keep hoping that at some point, everyone will come to their senses, and then we still have a shorter period of time to get these new technologies working together. Yeah. So, on the other hand, if in 2030 the world has become even less coherent, then maybe we should do the things that we do in this decade, should also work towards our security of supply. And there, why do I like hydrogen so much? It's an industrial gas. We can make it from lignite, we can make it from hard coal, we can make it from oil, from gas, solar, wind, hydro, nuclear. So,
And you can put it in our gas pipes.
And you can put it in. So, if we are beginning to invest, we assume that countries will keep their promise on Paris. Why not try to invest in a system that makes us robust, even if the world takes a different turn? Yeah. So, in that sense, and it will create a lot of innovation, and a lot of things will have to change. We need to figure out, of course, how to keep our industry competitive. Yeah? Maybe punishing them is not the way. Mm-hmm. But I'm optimistic about that. Yeah? And I do think that if the Europeans, or at least in Northwest Europe, we manage to make an example on how to do that, and bringing all our people along, that I'm sure also in Asia they will become interested, because it gives them that level of comfort with being part of the world economy without wanting to own everything for themselves. Because that's what China is doing now in Africa, it wants to own everything. Yeah. And of course, as long as the world markets work, that's fine, because they want to make their money as well. But we all know that when there's a political crisis, then the flows will go perhaps to China. Yeah, that creates a lot of uncertainty for others. So the question is, can we create a system? Europe is really a little bit in between the big powers. And so what mm-hmm. options does Europe have in order to kind of find its way, not being crushed, but also to be part of the future? I think that is our assignment. That's what you guys are doing. I mean, hey, I'm old, yeah? They're old guys, right, who are doing this fighting, so much older than I am. So there's, who knows, yeah? But you guys will have to figure that out, yeah? You have to help us to move along, yeah? Mm-hmm. And come with this new stuff from the universities, because there's so much technology still missing, yeah? I mean, we have it at the laboratory size, but we need it at industrial size, yeah? We still need to do quite a lot. So we need all hands there, but I'm optimistic about that. Well, whether the world will take a certain turn, you never know. Yeah? But, yeah, I'm just an energy person. I can't say whether there will be the conflict between the US and China will become a hot conflict. Huh? Mm-hmm. Or whether it's just all this war by proxy, yeah, hurting each other in a different way. I don't know.
Okay, one final question, then we round off. Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering, you are stating right now you're more of an energy person, which is of course made clear from now, but the question, you merely touched on energy footprinting. And it's all the solutions you say university people have to bring is mostly on the technologies on the production side. Why is it you're focusing on that rather than on reducing the use of energy mm-hmm. or maybe the reducing
just because I'm at the university.
Energy efficiency of it?
He wanted hope.
Good question.
What was I supposed to do? Tell him that it's useless? So the only thing I can do, I mean, I have a child your age. I'm not telling her that everything she does there might be for nothing. Of course not.
You're mostly focusing on the production side rather than
yeah. Well, that was a choice because I only had an hour.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, if you're quite welcome to come to The Hague, and if you can spend a week, we always have very long lunches where half the time we throw bread boxes because we disagree in the discussion. We talk about everything. You will enjoy, but we talk a lot about consumption.
Yeah? Okay, that made clear. Thank you.
It was just a choice because most of the geopolitical fight is about ownership of resources. And yeah, that was my interpretation of the question I got. So I'm sorry about
but
that.
That's good to know that perspective at
least.
Yeah,
yeah. No.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Kobi, thank you for giving this splendid lecture and answering all our questions. You took away a lot of myths in the energy field. One of them, for instance, is that the US is a exporter of oil and gas instead of an importer. That's something I didn't completely... Yeah, that was pretty new for me. Yeah. And for instance, the Germany, they exchanged... they are shutting down the nuclear plants, building a lot of solar and wind, but... The CO2 reduction is there's no...
Well, they had a little bit, 8% this year, but...
But
also the investments in wind are mm-hmm. in a deep decline.
Yeah. Those are also things I didn't know. Okay, I want a big hand for Kobi. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay.